study a PhD student in Durham University, and I'm looking at the relationship between wetland communities and dryland communities in later prehistory in the East Anglian fens. And in the fens, in the medieval and post-medieval period, you get these people described as fence lodges, and Wheeler talks about them, and he says they enjoyed a wild sort of liberty. Well, they were very miserable, but they enjoyed a wild sort of liberty living in these watery wastes, and they enjoyed a lifestyle that they were not disposed to give up, because the fen was their only source of subsistence. So these people hunted, gathered, and fishing, fowling, that kind of thing. Different from the farmers and the drylands around them, and it's clear that their identity is very much linked to this landscape, this wetland landscape. And in this paper I want to kind of consider that identity, environment link in a little bit more depth. So I'll talk briefly about the theory behind this, I suppose, and in particular about archaeologies of inhabitation and the dwelling perspective. I'll give a few wetland case studies, including of course these dangling fens. I'll talk about the fence lodges in the historic period, and then I'll briefly talk about my own research, which kind of takes it back further in time to prehistory, where I'm kind of, I guess, looking for the origins of this kind of distinction between the wet and the dry communities. And then I'll talk about what happened to these fence lodging people when that land was lost, basically, as people, or as it started being drained, and I guess that's where I, touch upon things that happened in Scotland. And then I'll very briefly talk about lessons from the past and potentially for the future, although you always have to be very careful with those kind of things, and I thought that might be a good thing. So this link between landscapes and identities and environments, they have been described in what we can, I guess, call archaeology of inhabitation, which is a set of phenomenological approaches, including the dwelling perspective, practice theory, and Ingold's tarscapes. I can't go into all the detail, but basically they look at people's interaction with the landscape and the environment, and how routine activities and patterns of movement on a daily basis basically create links between people and places and objects, and in that way identities are shaped. So if you live in a particular landscape for a long time and you live your life there on a daily basis, over time that kind of links you to that place, you develop a certain identity. And I think this is a useful approach because it breaks down these kind of modern dichotomies that we have in our minds between nature and culture and wetland and dryland, for instance. So these kind of links between landscape and environment are very clear in wetland landscapes. For instance, the marsh Arabs in Iraq are described as very different from the people living in the dry areas around it, and they see themselves as different as well. In New Guinea, there's a river people that clearly identifies themselves as being very different from the drylanders living around them. And again in Australia, you've got the saltwater people, they're hunter-gatherers exploiting a particular environment, they have particular skills and knowledge sets that others do not, and therefore they see themselves as different. So in the past, Van der Noort and O'Sullivan have described medieval fishing communities. These people would go out on a daily basis and interact with particular environments, which meant that they kind of took on a particular fishing identity, I suppose, different from the farmers in the fields. The Mesolithic Lower Rhine area is a similar idea. Hunter-gatherers lived in these landscapes for a long time, developed a wetland mentality, as Amkreutz has called it, and that over time meant that they actually dealt with incoming Neolithic novelties in a different way from the communities living in the dryland areas, which is really interesting, I think, that kind of identity and mentality affects the way that you then deal with new developments. And then, don't know what happened. I mean, fens, which I've already mentioned, in the historic period, you've got this clear, distinct community of fence lodges, people that live of the wild resources in this environment. And they're clearly linked to this environment. And they've, by their contemporaries, they're described as a half-savage population in a wild and utterly wasted landscape. Researcher has called them a singular people who developed a feeling of freedom and individuality and a culture unique from the rest of the island, that is the UK. He argues that is because of their inhabiting and exploiting this unique wetland landscape, basically. So it's clear from both these quotes that there is a clear link between the people and the land or the environment that they inhabit and exploit. So I guess in my PhD research, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to kind of find out when this started happening, when this kind of link most formed, so to speak. And this is where these angling fens are on the east coast of England. And it's a good research area for this particular question because it started out dry and kind of became wet over time. So I kind of wonder when, at what point, when people interact with this kind of wet landscape, did they become wetlanders, I suppose? Did they even? Is, I guess, the question. So I'm trying to contextualise later prehistoric fenland sites and communities in their wider sociocultural and physical landscape, and basically ask the question, did this identity develop, and if so, when? And how, if it did it affect wetlands' role in the wider sociocultural developments in the area? How did they interact with the dryland communities around them? So the objective is a broad-scale comparison of food waste to time and space. So I'm looking at the Neolithic to the Iron Age, and I'm looking at different environments, so wetland, dryland, and the kind of intermediate environments on the fen edge. Why food waste? Well, like I said, I want to look at this human-environment interaction that kind of results in particular identities. And food ways, many of those routine tasks that we talked about revolve around food ways, from the production to, you know, the preparation to the eating, etc. They take place in a physical environment and a landscape that poses, offers opportunities but also poses constraints. So wetlands are very rich in wild resources but may not be good for agriculture. And they are also deeply social and cultural in nature. What you eat is very much part of your identity or group identity, even today. So that's quite interesting. So this is my my site selection, I suppose. I've selected sites in the former fens, because they're now dry, and in the dry areas around it. Collected them in a database where you have a site which may have different phases, and in each phase you have different evidence categories, so wild and domestic plants and animals, pottery and environmental remains. I just tick the presence or the absence of these species. And now I have 145 sites and 440 phases, all of which have been assigned a main period, so one of 10 phases from the Mesolithic Neolithic all the way to the late Iron Age Romano British period, and they've all been assigned an environment, they're either wet, they're dry, or they're intermediate, so I can compare the three. For the first kind of round of analysis, I've kind of lumped all my individual species into different groups: domestic animals, wild animals, domestic plants, and wild plants. And the domestic or the wild animals I've separated out in birds, fish, mammals, and mollusks, because those are the kind of species that you find in fenland or wetland areas, and I wanted to look at them specifically. These are the results, just very kind of broad overview. I can't go into all the detail, but it's clear that the wetter environments on this side differ from the drier ones on that side. First of all, there's this kind of decrease in the wets and an increase in the drylands. And these resources I just mentioned, fish, birds, etc., are clearly more common in the wetter environments than the drier environments, which is not unexpected. So I've taken this all apart, I've looked at the different species, I've looked at the different groups and the different periods, and I've come up with a few kind of preliminary results. I guess it's more ideas really at this point, but I need to kind of do more analysis. But what I think happened in terms of identity development and the use of these wetlands is this. In the Neolithic, when the fen was developing, people were already using it, maybe on a seasonal basis to graze their cattle and so on. There was no true wetlands yet, I think, so no true wetland identities either. In the Bronze Age, people started interacting more with the developing wetlands, living on the fen edge and exploiting the resources within it. And that, in the later Bronze Age, actually led to them actually moving right into those wetlands. They colonized the fens, as it were. This is a reconstruction of Must Farm, recently found in the East Anglian fens, very well preserved late Bronze Age site. And the other one's Flag Fen nearby, also a site in that wetland. It's no longer on the edge, they're actually in it. And I think this is where you could argue the communities there would have, you know, maybe identified as wetlanders, or would have been seen as wetlanders maybe. Which is not to say, I want to stress, that they were not part of wider communities or completely different like in the historic period. They were very much in touch yet still, I think, with these people living elsewhere. There's clear evidence for interaction on the side of Must Farm, for instance, not just within the communities but also the communities in Europe. So in the Iron Age, the drylands again seem to become more important, or shift focus back to the drylands again. But you have continued exploitation of the fenland resources by either part of the communities or by some specialist communities living on the fen edge. And they might again have had a particular part of their identity might have been this kind of wetlander identity that I've been talking about. But again, they were probably trading with inland communities. I don't think at this point in time we can speak about proper fence lodging communities yet, so to speak. Of course, all this needs more analysis. I need to look at preservation and taphonomy, which are major issues in these kind of different environments. They preserve better in wetland environments. I need to look at the specific individual find categories rather than these big groups. And I need to contextualize all of this in a kind of wider setting, wider landscape setting, and the developments happening elsewhere. But it's clear, I think, that there's a long-lasting kind of intimate relationship between people and these dynamic wetland landscapes in this area. And in the medieval period, this results in a kind of definite wetlander identity, and people are very much bound to this wetland landscape. And by that time, there's this clear distinction of wild and wasteful wetlands and wetlanders, and civilized and cultivated drylanders. So it's a little bit like the situation in Scotland, I think, the outsiders looking in on the people living there and kind of describing them in that way. So it's no wonder that they went for improvement, as we've just talked about as well, an actual recovery of inning and of the inning of drowned and surrounded drowns, and all these kind of wet, wasteful spaces that we don't really need, really. So they brought in the Dutch, who were good at draining wetlands, and they started draining the fens, which immediately led to tensions, basically. The wetlanders, pretending to play football, which is interesting, started to destroy the works of drainage, and the country was again inundated as it formerly had been. So it's clear that Wheeler was right. They enjoyed a wild sort of liberty, and they were not disposed to give this up. They were really attached to this land. They wanted to keep it that way. They didn't want it to become dry. But eventually they lost the battle, I suppose. This is the fens now. It's a very fertile, agricultural, dry region. And therefore the wetland way of life, of course, disappeared as well. So, as McCullough says, the once independent and segregated fenlander slowly began to assimilate into the growing English national social order. So the local identity disappeared over time. So I guess, in terms of lessons, I don't know, I don't think it's a lesson, it's more a warning. The destruction of landscapes and environments leads to destruction of unique life ways and identities, and we've just seen that in Scottish example as well, I suppose. So climate change today is doing a similar kind of thing. Industrial agricultural development, tourism, I suppose, is another example. It's still happening today, basically. And once they're lost, it's hard to regain. I mean, once you change the landscape, you can't just change it back. Also, I'm not proposing that we should all become fence lodges again. That's not realistic in this time and age. But I think there's some lessons, especially if we look at the prehistoric fenland inhabitants, or, you know, the people engaging with these landscapes in prehistory. I think it's clear that they didn't think in these kind of dichotomous terms that we do today. They didn't see those different. They just saw the wetlands as part of a kind of a wider landscape that they could, you know, engage with and take things from, so to speak. And in a way, that is happening in places like Wickham Fen, which is a reconstructed part of the fens, I suppose. And often these days, those are natural areas where people are kind of kept out to give nature a chance to regain, to be re-established. But in Wickham Fen, they're actually actively reconnecting local communities with a wetland landscape. They encourage them to come in and to think about how they may engage with the wetland landscape. They also integrate archaeological and cultural heritage in this. So it's a kind of breaking down of this nature-culture divide. And I think that's very important. It's a different kind of engagement than the past fenlanders, but it still might eventually foster a kind of more local community, local identity. So in summary then, human landscape interaction over time results in unique identities, a clear strong link between people's, you know, environment and the landscape and their identities, like the wetlanders and the East Anglian fens in the UK. When these landscapes or environments are then lost or destroyed, so are these kind of local special identities. Although it's hard to regain them, I think we can still learn from the past by looking at how past communities kind of didn't see these dichotomies that we see today. And in that way, we could maybe reconnect with some particular landscapes and build more local identities, more localized identities, rather than the globalized ones, or in addition to the globalized ones, I guess. So integrating nature and culture to do so. Thank you very much.